Hello students, today's topic will be about RPD impressions. In this we will see definitions, RPD versus CD impression, primary impression, final impression methods, which includes Maclean's technique, Hindle's technique, selective pressure technique, functional relining technique, fluid wax technique, and altered cast technique. Definitions. Impression. Impression is a negative likeliness or copy in reverse of the surface of an object. Partial denture impression. A negative likeliness of a part or all of a partially edentulous arch. An impression of partially edentulous arch must record accurately the anatomic form of the teeth and surrounding tissues. Unless the cast upon which the process is to be constructed is an exact replica of mouth, the process can't be expected to fit properly. An accurate cast can be obtained only from an accurate impression. In order to make any impression, we need impression trays. Impression tray is defined as a receptacle into which suitable impression material is placed to make negative likeness, or a device that is used to carry, confine and control impression material while making an impression. There are various kinds of trays that can be used for impression making, such as stock trays, rimlock trays, perforated, non-perforated, coolant trays or custom trays. Impression trays can be classified broadly into stock trays and custom trays. Stock trays for partially edentulous patients may be perforated to retain the impression material, or they may be constructed with a rim lock for this purpose. Another type of stock tray designed for reversible type of hydrocolloid, that is agar, is water cooled trays. It contains tubes through which water can be circulated for purpose of cooling the tray. Disadvantages of stock tray include the peripheral borders cannot be accurately recorded, considerably more bulkier than a custom tray. Custom impression trays. In custom impression trays, peripheral borders can be precisely recorded in the impression and thickness of the impression material can be controlled. Well-fitted tray will better support the impression in the palate than avoiding even present danger of material slumping in vital areas. A brief description of impression materials: non-elastic and elastic. In non-elastic, we have plaster, compound, waxes, zinc oxidation or impression paste. Elastic, we have aqueous hydrocolloids, non-aqueous elastomers. Aqueous hydrocolloids include agar, which is reversible, and alginate, which is irreversible. Non-aqueous elastomers include polysulfides, silicones, which are again addition and condensation silicones, and polyether. RPD impression versus complete denture impression. A partial denture impression records relative soft yielding tissues as well as hard underlying substance, that is the remaining teeth. Whereas complete denture impression records the edentulous mucosa with underlying bone only. So in RPD you have to record both soft tissue as well as the teeth. Removal partial denture impression need to record the teeth that are irregular in contour as well as varying in their vertical relations to occlusal plane. The chosen impression material must be capable of recording the tissue contours as accurately as possible without distortion, which occurs as impression is withdrawn. Primary impression. Objective: to obtain an impression of all the standing teeth and denture supporting tissues of each jaw from which study casts may be prepared. Purpose of study casts: to enable special trays and occlusal rims to be constructed if necessary, to examine the occlusion in detail on an articulator, by the use of surveyor to plan the path of insertion of the proposed denture, arrive at a tentative design, and plan any mouth preparation. Special impressions: procedures for tooth tissue supported removable partial dentures. What is the main problem we come across if we have to make an impression for tooth tissue supported partial denture? Here, the tissues, the soft tissues will be moving, will be displaceable at a different rate when compared to the teeth. So you have to record both anatomic form of the teeth and functional form of the residual area. Factors affecting support of distal extension base: quality of soft tissue covering edentulous ridge, type of bone making up denture bearing area, design of partial denture, amount of tissue coverage of denture base, amount of occlusal forces, denture bearing area, and fit of the denture base. All these factors influence support of distal extension RPD. Impression methods. There are basically two dual impression techniques. Physiological impressions include McLean's, Hindle's, functional relining, and fluid wax. The other method is selective pressure impression. McLean's technique. The need for physiologic impression was first recognized by McLean. For this dual impression, a custom impression tray was constructed over a preliminary cast of the arch. A functional impression of the distal extension ridge was made. And then hydrocolloid impression was made with first impression held in its functional position with finger pressure. As you can see, the first picture shows the making of impression of edentulous area on which you are going to make an impression, you are going to make a pickup impression with the stock tray. So thereby recording the edentulous area in functional and anatomic form of the teeth with pickup impression. The great weakness of the technique was that finger pressure could not produce the same functional displacement of the tissue that biting force produced. Many variations of this technique have been developed and advocated, but all require some form of finger loading pressure as the second impression is made. Hindle's technique. Hindle's and others developed irreversible hydrocolloid trays for the second impression that were provided with holes, so that finger pressure could be applied through the tray as the hydrocolloid impression was made. So this picture shows the tray with holes for applying pressure. The main change that Hindle's introduced to McLean's original technique was that the impression of the edentulous ridge was not made under pressure, but was an anatomic impression of the ridge at rest, made with a free-flowing zinc oxide eugenol paste. As the hydrocolloid second impression was being made, finger pressure was applied through the holes in the tray to the anatomic impression. The pressure had to be maintained until the alginate was completely set. The main purpose of this technique was to relate an impression of the edentulous ridge to the teeth under a form of functional loading. A disadvantage of these techniques was that if the action of the retentive clasp of the partial denture is sufficient to maintain the denture base in relation to the soft tissues in the displaced or functional form, interruption of blood circulation would ensue with possible adverse soft tissue reaction and resorption of the underlying bone. Coming to functional relining method. Most methods of obtaining a physiologic impression for support of distal extension denture base accomplished the impression procedure before completion of the denture, usually following the construction of framework. It is possible, however, to obtain the same results after partial denture has been completed. The technique is referred to as functional reline. It consists of adding a new surface to the inner or tissue side of the denture base. The procedure may be accomplished before the insertion of the partial denture, or it may be done at a later date because of bone resorption. The denture base no longer fits the ridge adequately. Although the functional reline has many advantages, and for correcting the fit of denture base that has been worn for a period of time is essential, it does present some difficulties. The main problems that arise are caused by failure to maintain the correct relationship between the framework and the abutment teeth during the impression procedure, and failure to maintain accurate occlusal contact following the reline. To allow room for impression material between the denture base and the ridge, space must be provided. One of the most accurate methods of ensuring uniform space for impression is to adapt a soft metal spacer over the ridge on the cast before processing the denture base. After processing, the metal is removed, leaving an even space between the base and the edentulous ridge. They had up in this picture you can see adaptation of the metallic spacer. After the denture base is fabricated, the metal spacer can be removed to create the space between the ridge and the denture base. The patient must maintain the mouth in partially open position while the border molding and impression are being accomplished, because the border tissues, cheek and tongue are thus best controlled, and the relationship between the partial denture framework and the teeth must be observed. So the picture shows adding of the modeling plastic and completion of the impression. The functional reline method has the advantage that the most of soft tissue displacement can be controlled by the amount of relief given to the modeling plastic before the final impression is made. The greater the relief, the less will be the tissue displacement. Fluid wax functional impression. The fluid wax impression may be used to make a reline impression for an existing partial denture, or to correct the distal extension edentulous ridge portion of the original master cast. Objectives: to obtain maximum extension of peripheral borders of the denture base while not interfering with the function of mobile border tissues. To record the stress bearing areas of the ridges in their functional form. To record non-pressure bearing areas in their anatomic form. The fluid wax impression is made with the open mouth technique so that there is less danger of over displacement of tissue by occlusal or vertical forces. The term fluid wax is used to denote waxes that are firm at room temperature and have the ability to flow at mouth temperature. Make a note, its ability to flow at mouth temperature. So they are called as fluid wax. The most frequently used fluid waxes are Iowa wax and corrector wax. The key to use of fluid wax lies in two areas, space and time. Space refers to the amount of relief provided between the impression tray and the edentulous ridge. Generally 1 to 2 mm is desired. And time, each time the tray is introduced into the mouth, it must remain in place 5 to 7 minutes to allow the wax to flow and to prevent buildup of pressure under the tray with resulting distortion or displacement of the tissue. The clinical technique for the use of fluid wax calls for the water bath maintained at 51 to 54 degrees centigrade, into which a container of wax is placed. At this temperature, the wax becomes fluid. The wax is painted on the tissue side of impression tray with a brush. So the melted wax is painted onto the tissue side of the impression tray. The borders must be short of all mobile tissues, but not more than 2 mm short, because the fluid wax does not have sufficient strength to support itself beyond that distance. So 1 to 2 mm is ideal. Unicrisis will develop if the wax is extended beyond that length. The wax is painted on the surface of the tray to a depth slightly greater than the amount of relief provided. The tray is seated in mouth. The patient must remain with the mouth approximately half open for about 5 minutes. The tray is removed. The wax is examined for evidence of tissue contact. Where tissue contact present, the wax will be dull. If needed, additional wax is painted on those areas not in contact with tissue. The tray must remain in the mouth a minimum of 5 minutes after each addition of wax. The peripheral extensions are developed by tissue movements by the patient. For the buccal and distobuccal extensions in mandibular impression, the patient must move to a wide open mouth position. This will activate the buccinator muscle and pterygomandibular raphe and produce desired border anatomy. For proper lingual extensions of mandibular impression, the patient must thrust the tongue into the cheek opposite the side of the arch being border molded. The distolingual extension is obtained by having the patient press the tongue forward against the lingual surfaces of the anterior teeth. These movements must be repeated a number of times after the impression has been in mouth long enough for the wax to have softened sufficiently to flow. When the impression evidences complete tissue contact and when the anatomy of the limiting border structure is evident, the impression must be replaced in mouth for 12 minutes. This final time to be certain that the wax has completely flowed and released any pressure that may be present. So this is the completed impression. The finished impression must be handled carefully and the new cast poured as soon as possible because the wax is fragile and subject to distortion. The fluid wax impression technique can produce an accurate impression if technique is properly executed. The procedure is time consuming, but if the time periods are not followed accurately, an impression with excessive tissue displacement will result. The other technique is selective pressure technique. This impression technique attempts to direct more force to those portions of the ridge able to absorb the stress without adverse response. Tissue surface of the tray is selectively relieved. General impression materials here again, zinc oxide original impression paste or rubber based materials. First, technique includes border molding, making the impression with impression paste or elastomeric impression materials. The critical point here is to determine visually that all the rest and indirect retainers are completely seated during impression making. So here, first picture shows the adaptation of the wax spacer over which the framework is seated. Then a special tray is fabricated over it. This tray will be molded to obtain the master impression. So once we got this master impression, how we are going to replace it back in? How do we going to pour the cast and get the edentulous portion alone corrected on the cast? This is achieved by process called as altered cast technique. Altered cast technique is also called as corrected cast. This includes fashioning custom acrylic resin impression tray to retention lattice work of RPD, developing denture based impression on these trays, then removing edentulous ridge from master cast, securing framework with developed bases to master cast, and pouring the impression with dental stone. Simply, you will have to remove the edentulous portion of the master cast which you had obtained with previous impression, then seat the framework with new impression on the master cast and pour the edentulous areas to obtain an altered cast. As you can see in these pictures, first the impression is obtained, then on the master cast, the edentulous section is trimmed and removed. Framework is seated back on the master cast. Beading and boxing is done, and a new cast is poured. So by this, you get edentulous portions recorded through the impression back to the master cast. To conclude, for the production of accurate master cast, the impression technique far outweighs the selection of impression material. So, the practicing dentist should have a thorough knowledge of accurate impression making. These are the references, and thank you all.